Okay. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Today I have a talk about state of the art of electrical vehicle motors. So the talk will be about 2 hours. So maybe you will finish till the end. Hopefully it is interesting for you. Hopefully you can also understand me. And I will keep the microphone not too far from the mouth. Yeah. So consistency, so that at least the sound is possible. Well, first of all, of course, electrical vehicles is very important. And what we want in electric vehicle motor is speed. Because speed minimizes the volume. However, we all have a different conception on speed. Let me start with the first image. So this is what we consider speed. Yeah, if we drive an electric vehicle, if we drive an industrial combustion engine, this is speed. Yeah, so we assume 380 kilometers an hour in my Tesla is quite fast. Huh? I can only reach it downhill. Yeah, I cannot reach it uphill. Yeah, but of course the perception of speed is a little bit different in electric motors, but also it's different in other applications. So we also consider this to be very fast. This guy can run. Yeah, he can outrun most of us. Yeah, so this is speed, 44 kilometers an hour, which we usually convert, divide by 3.6, is 12.3 meters per second. This is speed. Let's go to the next example. This is also speed. I'm from the Netherlands, so I have to show you a bicycle. Yeah, so this is a bicycle, downhill. This is speed. So I can only move, I'm restrained. It's better. So I told you I'm from the Netherlands, I have to show you a bicycle. But I have to show you a special bicycle. I like mountain biking, but I don't like this. This is a little bit too much for me, even. Yeah. So the next one I would like to show you is a train, magnetic train. It's also an electric vehicle. Yeah. This is levitated. It's in China. It is German technology. Yeah. That is, I think, taken by our Eastern colleagues. 430 kilometers an hour. So that's 120 meters per second. If we look at an electrical machine, and for instance, we are developing flywheels still, yeah, you can see here, this is a flywheel. It's 3,000 kilometers an hour inside electric motor. Yeah, so the perception of speed is completely out of the range. Yeah, so we are 3,000 kilometers an hour, which means 900 meters per second. If we run a steel piece at that speed, it will just fly into the roof. Yeah, so we have to use very special materials like carbon fiber in order to contain this, because we are reaching extreme speeds in electrical machines. If we go smaller and smaller and smaller, we are going higher and higher speeds. Yeah, so power density is easy, because if we make a high speed, we can reach this. I think what is beyond this is only one step, is this one. Yeah, this is just beyond. Yeah, so 28,000 kilometers an hour is just beyond what we are doing. Yeah, so for today's lecture, I want you to relax, because for sure, electric motor design is not rocket science. Yeah, yeah. So don't worry. Yeah, so we are not going to 28,000 RPM or kilometers an hour. Yeah, we are going to 3,000 kilometers an hour. Yeah, so it's only moderate. Yeah, so in this rocket science, I would like to show you something. I would like to show you one equation, which shows here P, and the unit of P is of course watt, and it is joules per second. So it's energy per second. Here underneath is P equals torque times speed, and speed in this case is radians per second, equals force times speed in linear case. So being from the Netherlands, I thought, how can I explain this visually? So I thought, well, being from the Netherlands, we have cows. Huh? So we have a cow, and a cow is about, let's say, 700 kilos, 1,000 kilos, depending on the cow. It can run about 10, 14 kilometers an hour. So this is power, quite big power. Cow, if you stand next to it, quite a big animal. They're quite scary animal. Yeah, so what can I compare this with? I was thinking, okay, I can compare it with a cheetah. Cheetah, 70 kilograms roughly, so 10 times less than the cow, can run about 10 times faster. So instead of 14 kilometers an hour, it can run 132 kilometers an hour. So the power of these two animals is the same. It's the same power. So if we want to make an electrical machine with high power density, we have to make a cheetah. If we want a machine direct drive, with integrated gearbox for instance, we have to make a cow. Yeah? So these are the two things why motors become smaller. So why do we have very small motors? Because we want to increase the speed, omega, in rotational sense. We want to increase it as much as we can to minimize the motor mass, to make it very, very, very small. Then another thing is what happens if you scale up, if you compare the cow to the cheetah, is another equation. We have the surface area of the cow equals the surface area of the cheetah times the L of the cow divided by the L of the cheetah squared. And the volume of the cow equals the volume of the cheetah times the length of the cheetah divided by the length of the cow divided by the length of the cheetah to the third. This means that as dimensions increase, the volume increases, but the surface area does not. So the volume increases three times, surface area only with a square of two. This means that the bigger the motor, the more difficult it is to cool. Because if it is a big motor, the area only scales with the square. So that means that I have to do a really good job in a big motor to actually achieve the thermal characteristics, which I can also achieve with a small motor. So the smaller the motor, the easier it becomes to get rid of heat. So this is an inverse square law, which we have to deal with. So therefore, big motors usually have lower power density than a small motor. Small motor also because of cooling. So first of all, because we have the speed, the cheetah versus the cow. And then the next one is we have the volume of the cow versus the surface area of the cow. So the cheetah is much better at that. So it can get rid of its heat more easily. So if I want to show something what we do is we are from the Netherlands. So we are busy with dredging, mining, deep sea mining. So we are busy with robotics that are 5 kilometers under the sea floor and they are collecting all kinds of minerals all the way to shipping, inland shipping. And there's about 50,000 kilometers of waterways in Europe. And about 10% is in Netherlands. So we have about 5,000 kilometers, although we are like a poststamp. Yeah. So our country is very, very small. We have a lot of water. Yeah. We are fighting the water, but we are using the water in order to transport goods all through Europe, of course. Then the next one is student cars. Yeah. So we do racing. I cannot show all the racing activities, of course, but I can show you some of the student cars we do. And we are in helicopters. We always say we can do electric drives from the sea bottom all the way to heaven. I don't know where heaven is, but okay, let's assume that it's up there somewhere. Yeah, we have also made satellite motors. Yeah, so from all this range, we can design. From nothing to motor, we can design. So then, if we look at the powertrain of an electric vehicle, what we need is quite high torque. And the high torque mainly comes from climbing. We have to go up the hill. Up the hill costs quite a lot of effort. I know, as I mentioned, I'm a cyclist. Yeah, so it costs me a lot of effort to bring all this mass up the hill. Yeah, so usually I am quite sweaty. Then I see the Italian guy coming, whew, fast, yeah. But he's low mass, yeah, so it's easier. Electric vehicle has a battery. So it's quite high mass you have to lift into the mountain. The next one you need, of course, is wide speed range. Because we want to go slow, but we also want to go quite fast. Yeah, so we need the wide speed range of our electric motor. Then the next thing is, it has to be light, like a feather. Yeah, it has to be robust, like a rock. And it has to be cheap. And this is the only way we can satisfy our customers. That we achieve all these things in one package. Yeah, so we would like to provide this package to our customer. Then what we see here is that we can do this. Yeah, for different applications, we can reach different torque speed characteristics. This one is, for instance, for an electric superbike. I will show you the next one so you can take a better picture. Yeah, so here you see torque versus speed. Yeah, of course, we can decide what speed depending on the gear ratio. And this bike now goes 350 kilometers an hour. Yeah, so it is quite a fast bike. Yeah, we make the electric motor for it, but it's of course completely integrated in the chassis. It has to be a complete package. Yeah, so all has to work together. Then also you see that we have to do something with battery voltages. We have to deal with a battery that as soon as you pull power from it, it reduces voltage. Yeah, and it reduces voltage also on the state of charge. So if we actually drain the battery, it means that our voltage is going down. We have to take this into consideration. What happens then? What will we do with it? How do we regenerate? And so how do we also put power back to the battery if we break? So how are we minimizing the use of breakage, for instance, in electric motorbikes? This is quite a challenge because the rear wheel, of course, is not so good in regeneration. Yeah, in a vehicle, it's much easier. In a vehicle, usually all four wheels are quite well attached to the ground and we can use all four wheels in order to brake. In a two-wheel vehicle, like a motorbike, if we go too, if you brake too fast, people know that you are on one wheel. Yeah, this is what some people can do. I cannot do this, but some people can do this. Yeah, and then of course, you know that all regeneration, or most of it, is at the front wheel, at least at low speed. At high speed, it can be a combination, of course. And we have to deal with this. So here you also see that when we consider torque speed characteristic, we look at this depletion of the battery. If I look then at the electric drive system that can actually do this, I will show you a global overview of a mining truck. Yeah, so this is a global powertrain of a mining truck. So here we have the grid with the charger, but can also be connected. And so some people also have overhead lines, or they have a cable, or they have connection to the grid. Yeah, it does not necessarily have to be without the grid. So maybe you can make a combination. It can also be that this is contactless energy transfer. We also work on this. Yeah, so we can also provide a solution for contactless energy transfer in order to charge the battery while driving. Yeah, this is of course possible. So here you can see an AC to DC, which means I have three phases that are sinusoidally moving 120 degrees apart, and they are converted into DC. And this DC level can change, of course. It does not necessarily have to be that DC is a constant DC. If you control all the parts, you can even make the DC floating. So you can make it such that it is the perfect DC for your application. If people talk about 800 volts continuously, maybe it's not the right solution for a vehicle. Maybe the vehicle can also do 500 volts, 400 volts, 300 volts, depending on the application, depending where it is, or how it is used. And then we can also alter switching frequencies. So we can actually adapt the switching frequency to the specific application. But then, of course, you need control of all the components. If you take commercial components with commercial drives, this is not possible. Yeah, so if you have the complete system in your hand, then of course you can do a lot of things that other people cannot do. Therefore, we always say we make client-specific applications. So we make applications where clients ask us and we discuss with the client, what do you want? What do you really want? And how can we try to optimize for you? Here we see another one, a diesel engine. So this is a hybrid. We have a diesel and we have a battery. Of course, you can remove the diesel and can only use the battery, or you can add the fuel cell, or you can add ultra capacitor, or you can add a brake, or whatever you want. Yeah, so it can be extended as far as you can. Here you have the diesel engine with a direct drive PM generator, and then again you need the AC to DC converter. Here the battery. The battery needs a DC to DC converter because the battery will be floating. We have a floating DC link, so we have to float to each other. Yeah, so we have to alter the DC to actually match the DC which we want here. We can also remove this DC to DC. If we say, okay, we can remove this, we can just put the battery directly on the DC link. This is also a choice. Do I want this DC to DC converter, or do I not want this DC to DC converter? Here we see it's for a crawl drive. So here we have even a hydraulic drive. Yeah, so we have a hydraulic motor in the wheel. Yeah, it does not have to be hydraulic, it can also be electrical, but this customer wanted hydraulic. So you can have this, we can make this, of course we can. And then we also have a electric drivetrain. This one is with a differential, so we have a motor with a differential, but you can also have two in-wheel motors. Depend on what the customer wants. Do you want to use commercial motor? Do you want to use a special design motor? Up to you, yeah, up to the customer, what you want from us. So if we look at all these devices, what we see is we have a PPU, and we call it a power processing unit. So it processes the power from one form into another form. It can be DC level to a different DC level, is also a PPU, but can be also AC to DC. So all these PPUs you can use. And then of course you have an electric drive. An electric drive we call motor inverter together. So motor inverter in one package, we call it an electric drive. So what does this electric drive look like? That's the topic of today. So the electric drive we have here, and we're going to extend it a little bit. So we're going to look at the electric drive in more detail. What components? What is inside? What do we have? What do we need? So here we see the energy storage. Of course, can be a fuel cell, can be a DC, a diesel generator with a generator, but can also be batteries. So let's assume that we have batteries. We have a DC link, we have DC current, and we have DC voltage that goes into our electric drive. That's our source. So what do we do with this DC? Then on the other side, we have the load. So we have to know the load in advance. So we have to know the torque speed characteristic of the load at the back. So we actually always have to think at the application. What does the application need? How long do you need the torque for? Do you need peak torque? Do you need continuous torque? Do you need... So there's a lot of choices that you can actually make. Here you see the power processing unit back. So this power processing unit, in this case, is making from DC, AC. So it's making, for instance, from DC, three-phase AC, or six-phase, or nine-phase, or 20-phase, or whatever, Can be anything. But let's assume now it is three-phase. Well, then we have an electric motor. And that electric motor, we need, of course, AC, can also be DC, because if we have a field winding, we need both. So we need both AC and DC. So then we have more phases. And I will also, later on in the talk, talk about convertible drives, where we can actually go through the motor in order to charge the capacitor and back. So we actually have inverters on both sides of the motor. So power processing unit, not only on this side, but also on that side. So on both sides, you will have power processing units. Here we need, of course, control unit. We need hardware and software of control. Very important. This control determines everything. That's the heart, that's the brain. The brain of the electric drive is in this hardware and software. And of course, you have to think about this. You have to think about, okay, which hardware am I going to use? Which software? What are my limitations? What communication do I need? Etc. So here we need to interact with the vehicle and with the other parts, the other components of the drivetrain. And we have to decide, is it this a master or is this a slave? Do I listen to a centralized controller or do I make decisions by myself? So this is why you need this communication. Usually like CAN open, but you can also use Profibus, you can use Ethernet, EtherCAT. So it can be different communication protocols you can actually use. So that's what you see here. FlexRay is also possible, of course. And then on this power processing unit, we usually have auxiliaries. We should not forget about the light or the radio. Maybe the radio more important than the light. So we need music for the driver. So we need DC to DC converters there as well in order to make the auxiliaries. So to supply the net. That can of course be 12 volt, but can also be 48 volt or can be any voltage actually they want. And can be multiple DC to DCs, can be single one, etc. So this is what we call electric drive. If we then focus on the electric motor, in the electric motor we have a lot of options. So we have many, many options. People talk about interior permanent magnet. I do not know what is interior permanent magnet. I think I know quite a lot about motors, but there are so many choices, so many options, so many categories, I will dazzle you today. Because you will never have seen so many motors in your life as today. Because these are all options. The ones, the second one, so this is, we call it the spoke motor, because it looks like spokes of a wheel. This is what we call interior single layer, interior triple layer. This is what we call surface mounted, but half. This is surface mounted completely. Then we have Hallberg array, we have field winding, we have, it's endless. The endless options. So we always have to listen to the application. There's no single motor that serves everything. It doesn't exist. I mean, we should forget about it. There's no single motor. Induction motor tried it. So an induction motor in industry is a motor everybody is using. It's very standardized, but it's not the perfect solution. For sure, most people are overrating their induction machine. They are not selecting the right one for the right application. So this is just a small overview. I will go a little bit more extensive overview later. What we need to do, of course, is to look at the fields. So this is what you see, is a permanent magnet with the field lines. And this is iron particles, and iron particles illustrate to us what field lines are. Yeah, we actually call them equipotential contours, because they are contours of the equipotential. Yeah, they are actually not flux lines, they're just indications, because in between, we also have all flux lines. So actually flux lines would be completely black picture. Yeah, so but these are just contours of the equipotential that shows you where the magnetic field is going. So magnetic field is always coming in pairs. It's like the perfect marriage. Yeah, divorce in magnetism doesn't exist. Yeah, we have no divorce. Yeah, we always have the perfect marriage, because if I'm north, I need the south. Yeah, I cannot do without the south. If I am the south, I need the north. Yeah, so we need both to work together. And the field lines, by convection, they go from north to south. That's our convection. Yeah, so the enter the south part, this is the convection of what we use in electromagnetism. Here we see the flux lines, in between brackets I call them, because they are not really flux lines, in a motor. And here you see that it's loaded condition. So you see that the field is actually moving away from the center of the tooth. This is due to the interaction of the stator armature with the DC field. So we see that normally it's right in the middle, now it is already moving. We have to deal with this. If we move it too much, we will get out of the field. Yeah, we will do field weakening, but it might not be the right way to do it. Might be, but it is, yeah? This is a combination of DC field and inductance. Yeah, so induction machine is inside, because here there are damper windings. And damper winding is something that very little people still use, but can be very useful, also in PM machines. In PM machines, you have line start PM machines, but also other kind of PM machines, where we actually make a combination of an induction machine and a PM machine. So these two can actually work together. What we see on the right is something very powerful. If you're an electrical engineer, we can solve the world, because we can make equivalent circuits of everything. Yeah? So this is an equivalent circuit of the magnetic field. Yeah, so here you see resistances with an arrow through them. So they are variable. They are called reluctances or permeances. This is actually what we use to simulate the magnetic field. We have also sources. We have a current source. Yeah, so that's a permanent magnet. Permanent magnet is a current source. I am supplying the current into the magnetic field. So actually, this is a very, very powerful tool. Yeah, this is a powerful tool where we can make equivalent circuits. So we can analytically actually calculate everything. And then we use something like virtual work, that's what it's called, in order to determine the energy at one state compared to the next state. And if we integrate that, which is something we do, then we get torque or force or work. Yeah, so this is what we utilize in order to calculate all these kind of things. We can not only make a magnetic equivalent circuit, we can also make a thermal equivalent circuit. We can make a hydraulic equivalent circuit. We can make a mechanical electrical circuit. So actually this tool, if you know a little bit about resistance, inductance, capacitance, current source, voltage source, is something very powerful you can use in all kind of applications in order to make an equivalent model and to understand. Also stiffnesses. Yeah? So mechanical stiffnesses can be represented by an electrical circuit. That's a very powerful way of looking at problems or challenges. Well, what I would like to show is two main electrical machines that people sometimes confuse. So on the left side, you see a radial field machine, and on the right side you see an axial field machine. A radial field machine means that if I am the rotor, my field goes out that way. An axial field machine means if I am the rotor, this is axial. This is axial radial. Yeah? So these two you see next to each other here. People sometimes say one is better than the other. I will show you, I do not know. Depends on the application. Sometimes indeed, axial field machine can be better, but it has its particular challenges. Sometimes I would say radio field machine is better, but who knows? Yeah. So there is always a trade-off in every application, which machine to select. And even more complicated, yeah, we can make combinations of these. We can make a radial axial field machine and an axial radial field machine. Yeah, so then it becomes even more complicated. So here you see the magnets, yeah, that are radial, and the axial magnets. And here you see the challenge with an axial machine. So for instance, if you look at YASA, this is a YASA motor. It is a kind of an axial field machine, kind of. Semi, actually. It's actually not truly an axial field machine, but let's assume it is. Let's assume YASA is an axial field machine. Why they reach quite high power densities? Because they have quite some good oil. Their cooling is quite well. But why doesn't it scale very well? Why don't they use 25,000 RPM in their machines? Why are they not in 50,000 RPM in their machines? Why are they limiting their machines to about 5,000 RPM, 6,000 RPM, maybe 7,000 RPM? Why? Why is this? It's because also there's challenges. Because the lamination of these machines is extremely complicated. You need this kind of roll-up lamination, which is quite a difficult technique. Yeah? So in order to minimize the iron losses is something that is related to frequency and to field, magnetic field strength. So these two determine your iron losses. This is what happens in these machines. That's why they limit the speed. They can only go to a certain speed. So this is why not all machines are axial field machines. So this is also what I say. Yeah, so if you read here, yeah, if you read this, what is a nice thing about an axial field machine is that if you go to higher speeds, the containment is not in the air gap. Because if I am a rotor, I'm spinning, and I am facing that way, I have to put my containment here. I have to constrain myself, yeah, because otherwise at very high speed, I will be in the ceiling, yeah. So, but this is my axial field, so the containment is not in the air gap. That helps. It helps a little bit. Also, field weakening is quite nice. Mechanical field weakening is something you can do. So you can actually move the rotors a little bit and also achieve field weakening. But in general, an axial field machine is not so good in field weakening. It is not really suitable for that much field weakening. It is quite a challenge in order to get it to really high field weakening. What we need, because if you remember from the beginning, we need torque, we need, what was the second one? Torque, we need to be cheap. Yeah, that was the third one, we need to be robust. And the second one is we need to be, of course, fast, extended speed. Yeah, so we need an extended speed, we need high torque at the beginning, and we need extended speed. The torque can be a little bit lower, but we do need this extended speed characteristic. So that's what we need, and this machine for that is questionable. For racing, you don't need this, because you need the torque almost to the extended speed region. So therefore, for racing application, for high supercars, maybe hypercars, it can be a solution. I don't know whether it's the right solution, but it is a solution. So I don't know whether you follow the news, yeah, but this is in the axial field machine what you can do. So here you see the winding of the axial field machine. Here you see the magnets, and you can make all kinds of shapes. And so you can make very beautiful shapes on the axial field magnets in order to improve the characteristics, in order to smooth the torque. So we get more constant torque, or we get more higher peak torque, or we get higher. So this is what you see on the right bottom. You can do a lot of different shapes. And so reinvent yourself. Yeah, go crazy. Yeah, there's a lot of shapes you can try, and also thickness variation. So the magnet doesn't have to be completely the same thickness. You can change the shape of the magnet. You can change the thickness of the magnet. You know, do whatever you want. Yeah, there's a lot of options. If you follow the news, recently there was an announcement by Koenigsegg about their quark machine. It is the newest machine that there is. Well, I'm really sorry. It is not. Yeah? It is a combination of radial and axial field machines that people have used in academic world for a long time already. Of course not in the industrial world, so it's a nice solution. It's maybe a very nice solution, maybe. I don't know. But at least the numbers are not that impressive. Yeah? So numbers like this can be achieved also in other solutions. Yeah, so it is quite a big hype, yeah, at this moment. They are well advertising it. But I can show you this one. It is here. This is an axial and a radio machine in one. It was already done 20 years ago, 30 years ago. Yeah, of course we have done this. The difficulty with this kind of machines is that we get fluxes that become 3D. So in 2D, I can do very well. I can make laminations. Yeah, so the field, radio field goes like this. Yeah, and I resist the electrical current that goes to my neighbor. This is called lamination. Yeah, so I'm a lamination, not a lamination, and we don't talk to each other. Yeah, so I don't want to have a connection with him. I don't want to short circuit him. Yeah, but what is happening in this case is that the fluxes go like this. And then suddenly, how do you actually laminate? How do you make this lamination? So how do you actually isolate and not short circuit one part of the iron with the next part of the iron? This is quite a challenge. So people use at the moment soft magnetic composites. So soft magnetic composites is a way, and or amorphous metals is a way to get three-dimensional fluxes. But of course, we name it something like stacking factor. So every lamination, so if I'm a lamination and I'm another lamination, I have an insulating layer. So the thinner the laminations, the more percentage of insulation layers I have. So the lower the stacking factor. So the lower the amount of iron per length. In this case, SMC, I am an iron particle. The next iron particle has to be isolated from me. So we have an insulating layer in between. And of course it's in 3D, but I still have an insulating layer. In this kind of materials, iron losses is quite challenging. Eddy current losses is quite difficult to contain. Yeah, so there's a lot of challenges with three-dimensional fields. Of course, it's something that can be solved. Or of course, it's something we can work with. But it's quite a challenge. Yeah, but to say that it's new, it's not here. Yeah, so here you see one rotor, which is the axial field rotor. So this field goes like that, yeah, like this. Then here I have the radial field motor, like this. I even have a radial field motor to the bottom. Yeah, so I'm also going like that. Yeah, and then I'm also going from this side back. So actually from all sides, there's field coming. And that's what you see here. Yeah, so you have axial field, two axial field motors, two radial field motors on the side. Yeah, so actually from all sides, you have flux. You can also make multi-air gap machines. So not do one, two, but three or four or five air gaps. Yeah, so it depends on the application. A magnetic gear, yeah, so a motor with a magnetic gear, is also a kind of multi-air gap machine. However, one of them is a passive one. It does not have coils. It's an interaction of one magnet with another magnet. And if I change the number of poles between them and do a specific application, I become a gearbox. I become a magnetic gearbox without interaction. So that's also a multi-air gap machine. Multi-air gap machines, they're very nice, but they have tribology challenges. Because how to do the bearings? How to solve this? How to actually make a solution for that? That's quite some challenge there in order to do this. So if we look at electric motors and we start from the beginning, we have two of them. So we have power electronics, so electrically commutated, and we have mechanically commutated. Mechanically commutated is means that we use brushes. Sometimes very good. For instance, in certain countries where power electronics is less available, where there's less people educated to repair power electronics, maybe it's still a very good solution. For a battery application, vehicle might be also mechanical commutation. Very good. At the moment, with the shortage in devices, in the shortage in switches, in the shortage with everything that has related to electronics, it means that this machine is maybe still a very good choice. Then on this side, we have the power electronic, the electrically commutated motors. So we have two parts. We have the discontinuous field and the continuous field. So continuous field and discontinuous field. With discontinuous field, I mean that the field goes up, rises and falls again. With the continuous field, I mean it's more like sinusoidal. So it's more like a sinusoidal way the field is actually happening. If we then look at the discontinuous field, let's start with that. we have excitation on the rotor, or we have excitation on the stator. Can be both. Yeah, so this is just trying in the field of motors to make a characterization. Here we see brushless DC. Brushless DC means I have a field and then I go down. I have a field and I go down, and I have currents, DC currents in between in order to provide a smooth torque. Here we have excitation on the stator, then I have unipolar flux linkage and bipolar flux linkage. So this means that unipolar means I only go up, bipolar means I go up and I go down. And this is what bipolar means. Then here you see double salient, and here we call it flux switching. Flux switching machine is a new type of machine that not many people have. Commercially, almost impossible to get. Yeah, so only in academic research or maybe companies like us, they can design something like this. Because nobody uses this at this moment yet. Very rare. Then we have the continuous field. We have excitation on the rotor. We have non-excitation. So with non-excitation, we have synchronous reluctance. Synchronous reluctance is something nice for people that make AC induction machines. Because when you have an AC induction machine, you have the squirrel cage rotor, you take out the squirrel cage rotor, and you put in a reluctance rotor, then you call it a cool rotor. That's what they call it in the market. Yeah, because there is little eddy currents in the rotor. So inside the rotor, there's not so many losses. Because I'm only iron. There's only iron inside. Yeah, but you do have to make your field yourself. So like in an induction machine, actually the field comes from the stator and reflects through the squirrel cage into the stator again. That's how we create torque. We always need slip in order to create torque. In a synchronous reluctance machine, we do not have slip. Actually, it's a synchronous motor, but we need to provide the field ourselves. So you always utilize the stator a little bit less, because you still have to provide it compared to a pump magnet machine. And then, of course, we come to the excitation on the rotor. So we have the inductive way, which is an induction machine. We have a conductive way. Then we have a wound field synchronous machine. Then we have permanent magnets. And then we have the brushless AC. So this, of course, provides you with some free kind of energy. That energy you don't have to supply from the stator. So in terms of efficiency, in terms of power density, usually those kind of machines are better. If I make a small overview of this kind of machines, more in a picture way, you see this one. Yeah. So I go from a pump magnet machine to a reluctance machine. So I have the pump magnet machine, first the SPM, then the IPM, just a certain type of IPM. Then I have the HPM, which is the hybrid PM. Then I have the MPM, which is the magnetized PM synchronous motor. And then at the end, I have the synchronous reluctance motor. The one we just talked about, this is the cool rotor. Because here we have, in the induction machine, we have here a squirrel cage. And that squirrel cage, of course, currents go through it. If you look at the shaft power or shaft torque, yeah, because that's a derivative of this, but shaft power, you can see that the SPM is the best. The SPM torque at the low end is the best. You cannot beat it. Yeah? I'm really sorry if people say that interior is better. It is nonsense. It's not true. Yeah? Because at this moment, the magnet is at the surface and provides all its magnetic field to the opponent, to the stator, and you can utilize all that energy in your motor. So it has the highest torque capability at low speed. Yeah, especially for low duty cycle, this is even higher. Yeah, so SPM, very good. SPM sometimes not so good because of high speed, because in high speed we need to contain the magnets. So we need to increase the air gap a little bit. Yeah, so increasing the air gap, maybe IPM becomes better, maybe. The benefit of IPM is that it's, we call it in German, it's called Formschlüssigkeit. Yeah, so that the magnet is contained in the shape of the rotor. So you can actually easily hold it together. So if you rotate, the magnet doesn't fly out because it's held by some lamination, or at least some form of lamination. So that's what IPM machine does. And then of course you have the single layer, you have the double layer, and the double layer, they say that you can extend the speed a little bit better. So we talked about torque, that was the first one. Second one was extended speed, so that's the extended speed. So the IPM might be better in the extended speed region. And then we have the post-magnetized. And post-magnetized means I can magnetize the rotor in situ. So actually, I provide a very high current in the stator and I magnetize the rotor while we are running. Yeah, so while we are running, we are changing the set point of the permanent magnets. Yeah, so I can weaken the field by demagnetizing the magnets. And then when I want them very high, I magnetize the magnet. So I make a combination of a very strong magnet, which I need for high torque, and a very weak magnet, which I need for extended speed. Because those two are basically a compromise. Yeah, so you always have to compromise between how much base speed do I want, so until where do I want the constant torque, and where do I want the constant power to happen. So this is what you see in the post-magnetized. I actually have, for instance, like Alnico magnets, that you can magnetize quite easily, and I magnetize them with the motor. So the motor is actually used to magnetize those. And the last one is, I remove all magnets, and I have the cool rotor concept. I only have reluctance torque. And reluctance torque, by definition, is a little bit lower than magnetic alignment torque. Yeah, so these combinations, of course, is something that you can utilize. Well, if I look here, yeah, so these are different types of machines. And you also see that the winding changes. Yeah, so we also have to do something with the winding in order to change it. So here I start with induction machine. I have switch reluctance machine, which is a completely reluctance machine, which we call the bipolar or the unipolar, depending on the switch reluctance machine. But let's say mostly it's unipolar. I go up in the field and I go down. I go up in the field and I go down. And then here I have the flux switching. And in the flux switching machine, both my permanent magnets and my stator is in the stator part. So the rotor is just a reluctance rotor. Here we have the brushes AC, brushes DC, different combination, and then we have the synchronous reluctance. So this is just showing a small overview of what is possible. Well, if you then look at the next one, what is reluctance? Yeah, so in reluctance machine, I'm really sorry, you have a lot of options. So this is switch reluctance. Yeah, this is a combination of reluctance machine with an induction machine. Yeah, so the induction, the aluminum is in here, or copper, depending on what you choose. Here you have the interior, where the magnets are inside. Here you have magnets and squirrel cage, yeah, combination of the two. Here you see just the dual interior permanent magnet rotor. Here you see the rotor on the with pieces, yeah, so actually pieces. So this is a non-magnetic core with magnetic pieces on the outside in order to separate the field, which is very similar to a switch reluctance motor. Then here we have the combination of the switch reluctance motor and the interior, so the synchronous reluctance motor, and you get lost in all motors. Yeah? Even I get lost in all motors. So when people talk about an interior permanent magnet motor, I have no idea what they talk about. I have to think, what do they mean? Single layer, double layer, triple layer? Are they talking about purely synchronous reluctance? Are they talking about switch reluctance as well? Are they making a combination? What are they actually talking about? Yeah, so it's very difficult even for me to understand. And this has to do with saliency ratio. So saliency ratio, in simple terms, is the difference between LD and LQ. Yeah, so I have a direct axis inductance and I have a quadrature axis inductance. And this is a simplified mathematical way to look at motors. Yeah, so it's very simplified and maybe not applicable anymore. If you really want to go high performance, throw DQ out of the window, please. Forget about it. Yeah, really do the ABC control. Really do the control at the right level. Yeah, DQ is just a simplification to make, we always say, life of a student simple. But it's not really, really, really the best way, because it also only considers the first harmonic. Actually, motors don't have first harmonic only. They also have higher harmonics. So you have to consider your third harmonic, your fifth harmonic, your seventh harmonic, your ninth harmonic. Then you can say, okay, I connect them in star. So the third, the ninth, and the 12th, they disappear. Okay, very well, but then I still have the first, the fifth, the seventh, the 13th, the 17th harmonic that I have to consider. So if you do proper control, you do control, we always say at the assembly language level, machine learning level, yeah? So the lowest level. Don't use C++, go to the assembler. That's where you can reach ultimate performance of your electrical machine. But that's also what is shown here, yeah? So that's things you can actually utilize. Here you see all kinds of options that we already manufactured. Yeah? So any of these machines in the past we have manufactured. Yeah, so because we listen to the application And then the application says, okay, maybe that's good, maybe that's good, or maybe that's good. So these are just some examples of machines we have created. Yeah, so this is, for instance, the flux switching machine is there. Yeah, so we have built this already. This is a PM machine with carbon fiber. We have built it. Yeah, so this is a combination of a servo motor, special kind of servo motor with a very low inertia. We have built it. Yeah, so we have to look at the application. We have to think about the application, and then we can decide which motor to design for you, yeah, in order to provide you with the right solution. So if I look at the overview here of the PM machine, I can also have two different kinds of PM machines. I can have radio field from the inside to the outside, but I can also have radio field from the outside to the inside. So we have an internal rotor or an external rotor. External rotor might be very good, so this type might be very good for a wheel. If I want a direct drive wheel application, this might be a very good solution. It depends on the radius, depends on the dimensions of the motor. But this might be a very, very good solution. And you also have new types where you actually split the teeth. So here the tooth is splitted and I have DC field and permanent magnets. And so I have a DC field variable machine with an exterior rotor. And of course the name becomes very long because we make a combination of all kind of motors. We make a mesh. Yeah? We like this in the Netherlands. Huh? We put potatoes, we put vegetable and meat. We put it in one point and we eat it. Yeah, this is what we are good at. Yeah, so we do this in the Netherlands every day. We're used to this. This is our cooking style. Yeah? So here you see all kind of options, different options. Also to look at the winding. Do I separate the winding? Do I put them overlapping? Do I put them in different segments? How do I actually do this winding? What do I do with this winding? Yeah, so if you think, for instance, about aerospace or aeronautics application, if I have a short circuit, I cannot influence that guy. We still have to go home. We still want to fly. We still want to continue flying, even if I have a short circuit. So then I talk about unit reluctance, and I talk about all kind of interesting things. Whether that's the truth, whether it always works, we don't know. But at least we have to build in redundancy. And so we have to think about what happens. What happens if? Yeah, so do I look at the FMEA? In what range do I go? Yeah, so these are all kind of options which you show at the bottom. So all kind of winding options. Do I want them overlapping? Or do I want them in isolation? Or so it becomes a little bit more challenging. Yeah. So electrical machines, quite a challenging field. What we normally say to the, at least when I was teaching at the university, what we say is, if you want a challenge, come to us. Yeah, because electrical machines is a real challenge. Yeah, it's about magnetic fields. You have to know your differential equations very well. You have to know Maxwell equations. If you don't know Maxwell equations and you don't know your differential equation, please go to power electronics. Yeah, although power electronics are also complicated. Yeah, if you go into detail. So here you see on the x-axis and on the rotation, you see forces. So what happens in motors is that sometimes forces are unbalanced. And we get something that we consider noise. Maybe it is beautiful sound, but in English we call it noise. Yeah? And sometimes it's not wanted, this noise. Yeah? Sometimes people want the motor to be quiet. Sometimes I think it might be an advantage that you hear an electrical machine coming. So the electric vehicle can make sound, yeah, because the motor can also be used as a speaker, loudspeaker. Because the loudspeaker is also an electrical motor. Yeah, it's just an actuator with a permanent magnet inside. Yeah, it's just a simple coil with a magnet inside that is vibrating. So we also have this in the motor. We can make noise. If you want, we can make noise. Yeah. So we can actually make, you know, like a six, you know, like a six-cylinder car noise. Yeah, it's not a problem. We can do it via the electrical machine. Yeah, but usually it's not wanted. Yeah, because it also means that you have vibration. You have vibration, and vibration sometimes is not so useful for lifetime. Yeah, so for long lifetime, you want to minimize vibrations usually. Sometimes it's just a consequence of your choice. It's a consequence of what you selected. So it's not always that you can anticipate in advance, but of course you have softwares now. You have softwares to check and to see the forces on the tooth, the forces on the magnet, and you can actually look at the noise level. Here you also see that we are remagnetizing the motor. So this is different ways of remagnetizing, and then we can go to different levels. If we go here, it's how to integrate. Because in the end, the power density of the motor depends on the thermal capabilities. So how much energy or how much power I can extract from the motor. This is quite a challenging field. Yeah, of course, I can do it like YASA. I can put oil inside and it makes life easy. Yeah, makes life easier. But if you consider water cooling or in aeronautics, just air cooling, because aeronautics, they don't want water. They don't want glycol, they don't want oil, they want air cooling. Yeah, because air is quite good up there and they are at quite some speed. Yeah, so why not utilize that? But then it becomes very challenging. It becomes very challenging in order to make a nice machine to actually do the thermal analysis. And in order to actually make this into details that work. And it also depends on your choice of materials. Did I use permanent magnets? What is the maximum temperature of all components inside my motor? So the permanent magnet, let's say, okay, you have a very good permanent magnet, it can do 200 degrees C. If I have a very good containment, it can also do 210, 220, maybe 230. If I have an Inconel, maybe I can go to 300 degrees C. But it also has a limitation. If I have copper wire has a varnish around it. If I have a very good one, I can go to C, so I can go to, let's say, 260, 270 degrees C. But that's quite high already. And I get quite a lot of extension. If I have a bearing inside with grease and I have 260 degrees here, I have no grease in the bearing anymore. So I have to think about how to do this, how to actually keep grease in the bearing. So it's a big compromise between all these aspects. And that's also what you can do here. So we can make thermal models, we can make thermal analysis. Yeah, in different software, this is the MotorCAD software, but we also can do all different softwares. Yeah, we can make the equivalent circuit ourselves. Yeah, in order to analyze this in great detail, in order to look at different ways of actually cooling it. Here you see also different ways of building up the winding. Yeah, so you can do quite a lot of different types of winding. It does not have to be a round wire. It can also be a profile wire or a square wire, or you can connect it, you can glue it, you can weld it, you can solder it. Yeah, you have a lot of options. Yeah, we have also built electrical machines for 500 degrees C. We have built electrical machines for minus 250 degrees C. Yeah, so all these options are possible. Depends on the application, depends on the surrounding. What do I have? Where do I want to use it? So this is what is shown here. And also we have failures. So we always tell the customer, if we want to reach the edge, we will have a failure. Here you see a different type of machine. Different types of machine. This is called a homopolar machine. And a homopolar machine is something that is a little bit old-fashioned, maybe. Yeah, it was used in the past. It was maybe where machines started. Yeah, in order to say, okay, I can make a single pole machine. So that's what you see here. These are different types of homopolar machines. A new version of this is called, in 3D, is a transfer flux machine. A transfer flux machine also utilizes 3D magnetic fields. It is quite complex. That's why usually it's used for low speed, not for high speed application. Because the field also goes, like in the quark machine, it goes in both radial and axial direction. And maybe also backwards. Yeah, so it goes down, it goes axial, also that axial and that. So in a transfer flux machine, you have fields in all directions. This is quite challenging. Here you see a double air gap. Yeah, transfer flux machine. Yeah, so actually we have two sides. Yeah, so here you see the cocking torque, which is quite high, and there you see the torque. But this machine is extremely robust. It can be used for very, very high temperatures. So it has its application, but you have to listen to the application. You have to listen to the energy source, which was the battery. You have to listen to the torque speed characteristic, which you want. Either you want the high torque, the extended speed, and maybe this machine can still be used, depending on where you use it. Yeah? For instance, in the aircraft, where you have very high temperatures, in a turbine, where you have extreme high temperatures, this might be very, very useful, this kind of machine. So here we see the reluctance machine, synchronous reluctance. Synchronous reluctance has also to do with the stator. Because if you make too little poles in the stator, you will have very difficult time. Yeah, so you need sufficiently stator tools, yeah, of teeth, yeah, in order to actually make your synchronous reluctance work. If you make too little teeth, you really have a challenge. And the challenge is, of course, you can find it in papers, or you can ask us. Yeah, but it's quite a a challenge in order to design this well. And whether the induction machine as a general machine is useful for this, I do not know. Yeah, let's say that it's always suboptimal. So the next one is, can we make actually how to connect it? So this is actually looking at different ways to connect. So this is a dual delta. Yeah, because I talked about the star connection, where the harmonics already disappear. And if I make a star connection, the third, the sixth, the ninth, they all disappear from the voltage. They're still there, but you don't see them on the line. But they are still inside. So they still create iron loss. You should not forget that the third harmonic is always there. If you look at the phase voltage, the third harmonic is measurable. So it's something that you have to consider. So here you see different ways of actually looking at, okay, how do I make this multi-level? This is maybe four levels, but you can go to six levels, eight levels, whatever is necessary for the application. Here you see another application where we have made a combination of the flux switching machine. So we have a single tooth winding with a permanent magnet inside, and we have a reluctance rotor. This is called the flux switching machine. And it's a special kind of machine, which you can see here, which you can also use in different applications. So some applications, this is very good. At the bottom, you see switch reluctance motor. Of course, we also develop switch reluctance motors. Difficult thing with the switch reluctance motor is that it needs different power electronics. So a MOSFET with a parallel diode is not so suitable for a switch reluctance motor. So therefore, quite a difficult motor. Also, power factor of a switch reluctance motor, so how effective is real power transferred into torque and speed, is not so good in a switch reluctance motor. It's quite a challenge in order to get high power factor. Here you see another one, the DC field excited machine. This is quite a good one. It's a Renault Zoe, for instance, has it. So also the Mahle, they are now doing the contactless energy transfer to the rotor. It's not a new machine. It is there for a long time. A lot of people have used it. All synchronous generators are like this. So it has been there for a long time, but suitable. But we do have to deal with quite some harmonics in the air gap. So actually the harmonics in the air gap is quite a challenge, because this relates to iron losses, and iron losses are quite high in this kind of machines. So you have to think about how to deal with this. Here you see also the thermal behavior. And here you also see two inverters. So this is also where we already start to think about the inverter. So we cannot only think about the motor, we also have to think about the power electronics that is supplying the motor. You cannot think about the motor in isolation. So from battery to torque speed, we have the power processing unit, and then we have the electric motor. We have to think about both of them. We cannot forget one of them. And so we cannot say the motor is the best motor, and the power processing unit, you will do your thing, what I want. It doesn't work like that. It's actually a combination of these two. And you have to look at that combination. So here what we look at is, for instance, two inverters. And what you can do with two inverters is that you can start also to do interleaving. So you can actually make two inverters, you can make them work together more effectively in order to simulate a higher switching frequency with a lower switching frequency. So you can simulate all kinds of things with two inverters. Here you also see the exciter winding. So like Mahle is doing it with contactless energy or wireless energy transfer, you can also do this with the rectifier. So there is a lot of machines out there where we have a stator, we have the rotating rectifier, and that rotating rectifier is supplying the DC field. So that's another way of actually supplying the DC field. It costs a little bit space, but maybe space is not always bad. Space can also help you in thermal behavior, can help you in other applications, can help you in, okay, so there's a lot of options. Then here, what is this? This is actually combination of a magnetic gear with a flux switching motor. So it has pole pieces in the air gap. So it is a double air gap machine where we have, this is like an air gap here, two sides, and we have a stator on the outside. So we actually have a dual air gap machine with flux poles that are rotating, including magnets. So now the machine becomes really complex, and we have to spend more than 2 hours like today in order to explain this kind of machine. But it's also a kind of a combination of a switch reluctance motor with a brushless AC motor. So it is making a combination between those two motors. Here we see that we have to consider the power electronics. So this is the simple power processing unit, but we have the six switches, and these six switches, they supply the three-phase winding. And so this is the simple machine. We have an LA, LB, LC, which is the synchronous inductance. So it's not inductance, huh? It's a synchronous inductance, which is a combination, mathematically, of the self-inductance and the mutual inductance. But actually, you should use a matrix. Yes, you should also use all the cross couplings. But in this case, this is showing the synchronous inductance of that machine. Then I have the, in this case, MOSFETs. So I have a transistor, the switching device with the anti-parallel diode that is actually conducting while the switch is off. So you can actually, if you have all the switches off, this is a passive rectifier. And then we have the DC winding. So what we can do with this? What can we actually do with this kind of application? Is this the end? Is this what we all should use? Maybe not. Maybe we can also think about another inverter and connect the DC links together and think about an inverter on one side and an inverter on the other side. Now we can do very interesting things. We can move power from one side of the motor to the other side of the motor. We can even use it as an inductor for your charging. Yeah, so charging via motor is something that some OEMs do. So they utilize the motor also during charging, because you need inductance in the circuit of your charger. Yeah, so the motor sometimes is utilized in this respect. So here you can do quite a number of interesting things. It opens up opportunities. It also opens up opportunities to do the multi-leaving. So one switching frequency on the other side, desynchronized on the other side, and you interleave them. Interleaving means that the motor sees a higher switching frequency, usually better for the motor, because we want more perfect sinusoidal waveforms. So our waveform wants to be as sinusoidal as possible in order to minimize losses. If you look at normal standard induction machines, they put a really big filter here. Yeah? This filter is gigantic. Yeah? It is sometimes the size of this table. Yeah? It costs about 7% of energy. So why? Why is this? Just throw it out the window, yeah, and think about what you're doing. If you think about what you're doing, you don't need this filter. But maybe everything becomes a little bit more complex. So what we can do is we can increase the voltage. We can increase the power with the same devices. We can make it fault tolerant. So if we have a short circuit in one of the phases, we can eliminate that phase and run on five phase. Yeah, we don't necessarily have to take the whole inverter out, we can take one phase out. Because a motor can also run in two phases. It's not an issue, depending on the internal structure of the motor. And the other one is what we can do is, we can actually do something with the common mode currents. And what is common mode current? Common mode current is if the phases are not balanced, I get a circulating current. And this circulating current is causing quite a lot of hassle. And especially in electric vehicles. Because the circulating current is killing your bearings. It gives arcing in the bearings. It is something that is quite an issue, a challenge to solve. It's not an easy fix. Yeah? And it is, if you have it, it is very difficult to get rid of. Yeah? So there's a lot of research at this moment in tribology, yeah, in order to see, okay, what happens with this common mode currents? Because you always have common mode currents, actually. Yeah, they're not there. Because we also have capacitance. I don't go into details of this, but we can make a capacitance network of the motor as well. And that's where common mode currents come from. Yeah, it's actually guiding the current all the way through the earth or through the miners or through the, depending where they can go fly back. But they are actually circulating. And they are circulating through your motor, and that's in the bearing, we call it pitting. So actually we get small arcs in the bearing balls and we get pitting of the bearing. It is a disaster. Yeah, so it's very difficult to get rid of. It is quite a challenge, but it's there. We have to deal with it. Yeah, so we have to think about it. Actually with this configuration, you can do something about it. This allows you to do something with common mode currents. You can maybe even utilize them. in order to get more torque. The negative is, of course, that we have more devices, because we have 12 devices instead of 6 devices. Huh? So, of course, we need 2 controllers. Huh? We need to control 12 switches instead of 6 switches. So the switching loss is also higher, huh? Because we have, of course, the double number of components. And then the last one is the failure rate. They always tell me that a single aircraft or single motor aircraft is better than a 4 motor aircraft, because there's less chance in failure. I don't understand these statistics. Yeah, I prefer the 4 motor airplane, but the single power airplane, a single motor airplane, is actually better from a statistical point of view. Yeah, that's the same here. Yeah, so failure rate, if I have more inverters, actually goes up. So I have to consider that I have more failures. And a failure in a power electronic device can come from heaven. Actually, many, many problems with switching devices come from the sun. The sun is shooting protons, and protons give a short circuit in my switching device and actually kills the switching device. So actually, heaven is influencing our power electronics here on Earth. Yeah, so we have to also deal with that. Yeah, so we have solar radiation, solar issues. So also in aircraft, we have to think about this. So even if you have six switches, you can have an issue, because this happens. This is real. This is there. Yeah, although nobody thought about it when they created power switches, but it's something we have to deal with. Well, we can also make the machine modular. So if we have 2 inverters, why not do also something with the machine? I'm listening to my power processing unit. I am the machine. He has 2. I also want 2. Yeah, so let's make it 2. Yeah. So if he has 2, I want 2. Yeah. And then I become something like this. Yeah. So now suddenly I can use multi-levels in multi-configurations, in multi-segments, in multi-multi-multi-multi. Yeah. So it becomes extremely complicated. Yeah, but this is a very nice topology. It's very good. You can, of course, you have many, many switches. Yeah. So what people call this, actually, we replace copper with sand, because sand is silicon, and we have the silicon devices that are the switches. So we are replacing copper with sand. Yeah. So we use less copper in the motor, but we use more sand, yeah, in the switching devices. Here you see quite a number of devices, of course, and you can level them. You can also utilize them in order to make variable voltages. So if you cut the line here, for instance, yeah, or cut the line here, you can actually make different voltage levels. You can actually transfer power from one side to the other side and back. We call it multi-port. So you can actually have multiple ports in order to connect them together. And of course, this can be extended. It does not limit to this dual. You can also do 4, 3, 4, 5, yeah, etc., depending on the application. Sometimes also it helps to not have 800 volt devices, but 100 volt devices. Because a 100 volt device is better than an 800 volt device. It has lower on-state resistance. It has less switching losses. So if you have an 800 volt device, maybe multiple 100 volt drives might be a solution. Yeah, so it's not necessarily that I should have one 800 volt inverter. Maybe I can utilize modular inverters in order to achieve the same thing. Yeah, so it depends. This increases the range. So I get the extended speed range becomes much larger, because I have an electrical gearbox. This is created an electrical gearbox. Yeah, so I can actually make these appear in series, or I can make them appear in parallel. So I have now created a multi-configurable winding inside my machine. I have improved the fault tolerance, because if one leg fails, I have still 5 plus 6, 11 left, yeah, in order to create torque. Modular design, as I mentioned, and this is scalable. I can scale this to multi-megawatt level. Actually, this is not such a bad idea, and this is also what industry is doing. So if you go to medium voltage or high voltage, yeah, like the Siemens, what is it, the Perfect Harmony. Yeah, they use low voltage or medium voltage drives and stack them in order to reach the high voltage level. So also in commercial drives, this is actually utilized. Then we have the negative is, of course, we have even more switches. We have more switching loss and the failure rate. As I mentioned, the single versus the four engine aeroplane. We also have an 8 engine aeroplane or the 16. Yeah, this is, of course, failure rate goes up. We have to deal with it. Well, if we look at it in more detail, we can also make an additional switch in between. Combinations become endless. Yeah, I mean, be creative with your switches and we can create something else. Yeah, this can be just normal contactors, so it does not have to be a switch. Therefore, there's no diode there. It can just be a contactor because it's quite slow. You don't have to do this fast. Yeah, so it's like in the past when my grandfather made a car. And he had a DC motor, he had a lot of switches. Yeah, and because then he could change the voltage from 12 volt to 24 volt to 48 volt in order to reach different speeds. Of course, switching loss is less, and but we have more, even more devices, more failure rate. Then you also have to think about your controller. So, as I mentioned, we can look at DQ. So DQ is a simplified control structure, which we use here. We use at the SVM, space vector modulation, because space vector modulation gives you quite nice voltage range. Yeah, you can even do over modulation to get even more voltage range. And then we have the field duty. And here you see that with a DC excited machine, you can actually utilize both. And you can use different strategies. So like you have in a race, you can take a pit at 10 laps, but you can also take a pit at 15 laps. The same what you can do here. So you can use different strategies in order to control the motor. And you can play with different sources. So you can put the field winding a little bit harder, and then the stator winding a little bit less. And you can make a combination of these two. So you can make a combination of these two in order to make the perfect controller for that application. So this is changing both of the DC field and the AC. Here's another one. So it's a modular way. But the problem with this motor is that we have to have quite a bigger drive. Also, if you look at the commercial systems out there, you have to select a drive which is a little bit bigger because power factor is lower. We just have to deal with this. So your inverter has to be bigger than normal. So here we look at the controller. So looking at the controller, this is the phase diagram. Here we have the x-axis, the quadrature axis, and the direct axis. And we have, of course, the voltage source. So the V equals IR plus LDI dt plus E. Then we see E and IR, because that's what you need. This is steady state. Here you have the IS, which is the equivalent stator current. And here you have then the flux linkages. The flux linkage in the S, in the Q and the D axis, and then the total flux linkage. So that's what you see here. And these are the D and Q axis where you take them apart. This is the simplest way of looking at your controller. So this is making, they call it Clarke-Park transformation from ABC to D, to A, alpha beta to DQ. So you have two transformations and then you get to this equivalent circuit. So this is also basically an electric equivalent circuit of your controller, of your machine, of your magnetization. It's also an electrical circuit equivalent. And of course, we have to be actually more complicated than this. We also have to think about cross couplings. We have to think about saturation. We have to think about many more things in our electric drives. So we have to think about nonlinearity. So the nonlinearity is there. So the nonlinearity shows that actually, if I put extra current, I might not get the extra flux linkage that is coming back. So I have to think about how to deal with this nonlinearity. So what I normally talk about, if we have torque and we have current, linear means that the torque is rising linearly with current. And so if I have torque here and current here, it's linearly rising. But at some point, if I put more current, the torque doesn't rise linear anymore. It actually is fading. And this fading we call saturation. Saturation of your motor or saturation of your magnetic field. Yeah, so it is called differently. And that's what you see here. So we have non-linearities. And the other one we have is position dependency. So actually it depends on where the rotor is, where whether I have this or not. So actually I have two of them that I have to deal with. So here you see a motor, a switch reluctance motor with a field winding. Oh, this one is with field winding, this one is with the permanent magnet. So we call it a pre-biased switch reluctance motor. So actually we have another field that is adding to the general field. And what then happens is we actually raise the level, the average. Yeah, so here you see flux linkage on the y-axis, you see position on the horizontal axis, and you see that the level is rising. That's this pre-bias. Pre-biasing rises the level, raises the level. However, we can still see that at this moment we have here we have flux linkage, and here we have position, that we have quite a sinusoidal behavior. So inside the coil, you have actually quite a sinusoidal behavior, although you have complete what they call unipolar or bipolar, in this case bipolar fields in the air gap. So you can utilize these kind of machines in order to remove all the parts from the magnet and go to quite high speeds. And so this is a machine that is quite suitable for high speeds, and it has quite a low inertia. If I look at that machine, it's actually a combination of a switch reluctance machine, which has a low torque density, or relatively low torque density, depends what you call low. But it has a very robust rotor structure. So the rotor structure is very robust because it's just lamination. And I have another one, it's a brushless AC machine. And if I make a combination of these two, I add them together, I actually get this flux switching machine. And in the flux switching machine, actually the permanent magnet has moved from the rotor to the stator. And it is incorporated inside the stator. And here you see that the flux is switching. That's why it's called the flux switching machine. So in this side, the flux goes up, and this side, the flux goes down. So I'm switching from radial up to radial down. Yeah, that's why it's called flux switching. Yeah, or switch fluxing, or whatever you call it. Yeah? So there's different names, of course. For new machines, nobody knows exactly how they name, so somebody just gives them a name. Yeah? And we start to get used to it. Here you see it being built. Yeah? So this is an example of whether it is built. This is the back EMF, extremely sinusoidal. Yeah? So what you would expect from a brushless AC machine. So if you look from the outside, you cannot see what is inside. You will only see the sinusoidal back EMF. You have no clue what is happening inside. So this is very suitable for normal controllers, for normal control purposes. The torque has a small ripple, but it's quite straight. Yeah, there is a small ripple torque always, but it is not so big. Here you see different kind of machines in order to look at the air flow. So we use cowling. So if, for example, in aircraft, we have to think about how the air will flow over your electrical machine. How will it actually happen? Because I'm increasing the pressure. So the outside is actually easier. So you have to think about your electrical machine in combination with your propeller. Because you can help the propeller even. Because you are creating a high pressure path which pushes your air to go outside. So there's a combination possible between those two. So you can actually utilize this kind of machine. So here we look at how to cool it. Yeah, so how to provide the air cooling inside that machine. And then for different options. If you have linear material, in this case, we look at the psi I curve. Psi I curve gives us an indication of the energy that is actually provided. And then we have, of course, linear material and we have non-linear material. And you see that there is a difference between the two. So this is actually what we utilize in order to check our analytical models. If we make a magnetic equivalent circuit model, we can do very fast optimization of motors. We can use it very well. But we always have to check with finite element analysis, for example, whether our machine is really illustrating the nonlinear behavior. And that's what's shown here. we always look at this combination. If we are designing motors, I think we are, there's not so many people that do this, but we are looking at the combination in order to know whether that is the truth or not. What we look at is integration of the motor and the drive. So nowadays we are looking at putting the inverter in the package. So we have all the issues and you have less issues. So you only supply us with the DC and we take all the issues internally. So the difficult cables, the EMC, the EMI, etc. We take everything inside. For this we have a lot of options. So we can put, of course, this is the standard option when you have the electrical machine, EM, and PE is the power electronics. You take them separately. So this is the traditional way and you need the difficult cables. And this is also governed by, of course, the standards. So this kind of machine for grid application. You can also do non-drive end. So put the power electronics behind the machine. We have an example on our stand where we actually do this and we utilize this inner piece for cooling. But you can also do it on the drive end. So you can put the power electronics in front of the motor. Depends where you want it. Depends what is more suitable for the motor. Then you can also put it in the terminal box. So you can put it on the outside of the motor. You can put it on both sides. So surrounding. And then you can also use a modular system. So a modular system where you can take out part of it and replace it and even do hot swapping. So you take out part of the machine with the power electronics and put a new part of the power electronics and the machine inside and it still runs. You can do this while running. So all this is possible and we call it individual IAS. So these are different options and from the 1st of July 2021, we can only sell IA3 motors in the industry. And so in the industry, we are only limited to certain type of energy efficiency class. And so we are protecting our industry and also we are trying to minimize our energy bill in order to make more efficient motors for the general public. So that is governed in this legislation. What we do is the integration of the two. And what we can do is do the contactless. So we have Bluetooth connection to our drive. We can program it with the Bluetooth connection, but you can also have the communication. If you want a CAN communication, we can provide this to you. So this extra Bluetooth connection gives you a lot of options. Because all these auxiliaries are not necessary anymore. So these auxiliaries are integrated in our app. So that app has a capability of logging, because you have quite a powerful computer inside your telephone. So you can do the logging, you can do parameter setting, you can change the range, you can do quite a lot in the app, which we have. So here you see the combination. So on the left you see the traditional, where you have to do quite a lot of wires, quite difficult, and the right side you see our solution, where you have no cables. So we always say anybody can do the job as long as they can distinguish red and black from each other. Because we have two cables, we have a plus and a negative, and one is red and the other one is black, and you have to connect them to the plus pole and to the minus pole. So if you can connect these two cables, then you can utilize our solution. This is an application where we use this. So this is an application where we have integrated power electronics and motor inside a wheel. This is our solution which we have at our stand with motor, cooling and then power controller. And what we can do is we can actually extend it. So we have a modular power electronic system. We have an S1 all the way to an S4, S8 in order to go to very high power levels. What we have is less components, we have mass reduction and we have volume reduction. Here you see that of course the app can work. And that one, the motor plus the app, because we have an integrated motor, we have all these opportunities. So you can vary the speed, you can set the speed, you can set the duty cycle, you can do precision control, you can do whatever you want. And all these parts are now utilized inside the motor. So looking at you don't need a laptop anymore. So you can use on your mobile device, you can look at all the waveforms. So here we have the drive, we have the control, and normally you have an on-on switch. You have, for instance, a gas throttle, a throttle or a variable resistance. You have the potentiometer, you have the voltage supply, you have the computer, and all that we can do in with our drives, and then we can do the monitoring. That's what you normally do. And so you look at all the monitoring of the different, with using the different devices, and the bottom one is a power analyzer to look at the powers. We can also do that in our motor, of course. So what we do is we replace this with our app. Yeah, so our app, you have the sliders, you have the parts where you can set it, and then you can see the speed, you can see the waveforms inside the mobile app. How does it work? So we have all these different screens, and then we can monitor. We can monitor battery capacity, we can monitor speed, current, torque, power consumption, temperature, we can do warnings, visual warnings, vibration. So you can make the phone vibrate in order to say, okay, hey, something is happening with your drive, be careful. You can also say, okay, I don't want to exceed the limits. You can limit the limits as you want. And then you can adjust parameters. You can set the speed, you can set the torque, you can set the emergency stop. So all these things are possible. And you can give the customer access or not. Yeah, so we have special service levels where you can say, okay, I want that level for myself and this level for the customer. Yeah, so this is all possible. Of course, also in this case, we are doing customer specific. So we have all the technology blocks, we have them ready. Yeah, we have them ready to a certain level, but for a customer, we can make specifics. So we can also rebrand this. So this can be your logo, not our logo. Yeah. So we also do rebranding. So we don't need to be here, but we just show that we can do it. We have the capability. Yeah. And then we need, of course, customers in order to say, okay, I want this. I want this for a specific application. Please make this or extend this or whatever you want. Well, if we look about high-speed machines also comes with an issue. And the issue is rotor losses. And rotor losses is something we have to consider. And rotor losses can be threefold. They can be electromagnetic, they can be mechanical, and they can be system. Yeah, so both, all three can be causes of rotor losses. And what we know is that there is very little information about measurements. Very little people measure rotor losses. It's very difficult. Yeah? Measuring rotor losses is a challenge. Yeah, because of course this thing is rotating. How to measure the temperature? If I stop it, the temperature changes. So how do I actually do this? And here we have to look at, of course, basic equations. That's something what people sometimes do. You have to, you can determine the power dimension, the density limits, and you should consider the PWM. Because the PWM from the stator goes into the rotor and causes rotor losses. Well, what we made a challenge, so we made an overview of all kind of PM machines, induction machines, wound field machines, and we made ourselves, there was a customer with a specific request, and he wanted that. Yeah, so he wanted 20,000 RPM, 2 megawatt machine. Yeah, so we designed for them this design target. So what do we do? How do we do this? And we look at that application, they wanted to minimize the machine volume, they want to be very reliable, so they wanted as little power electronics as possible in this application. They wanted to eliminate the mechanical gear train, so it had to be direct drive, so there was no option for a gear. And they wanted to think about assembly issues, so they wanted to be simple to take apart and to put back together. Okay, so that's what we look at. And then we decided to go, in this case, for a brushless permanent magnet generator, because it has advantages and it has certain disadvantages. And in this case, the advantages overwon the disadvantages. So, how do we start? Then we start, first of all, with mechanical FEA. So we start to look at making a drawing, make a model, and we look at surface elements in order to, because we have a magnet spinning, so we have to contain the magnets on the rotor. So we get from that, we get rotor dimensions that can be maximum used. And we also get containment thickness we have to use in order to contain the magnets on the rotor. Then we incorporate the motor dimensions in our analysis. So then we get the magnetostatic FEA. That means that we are looking at static FEA in order to get the back EMF and the inductances, both self and mutual inductance. Then we go to a simulation package. In this case, it was Sabre simulation, which is like an extensive simulation package where you can do motor, or at least the equivalent of a motor, but you can also look at very detailed electronics components, including snubber circuits, including all kind of capacitances, including, so you can look at very detailed power electronics. You can also use PSPICE or LTSPICE if you have limited nodes, or you can use all kind of other options, but we use chamber simulations. From that, we get the current waveform. We get the current waveform that actually is the result of our generator. Then we have to go to dynamic FEA, because dynamic FEA we need in order to look at, okay, what are rotor losses, iron losses, magnet losses, etc. Yeah, so from that, we get stator iron loss that we feed back into our magnetostatic FEA, but we also get the transient. So we get the eddy current distribution, we get the magnet loss, and we get the copper screen design. So copper screen you can use on the rotor in order to screen your higher harmonics from your rotor. It's a way to minimize rotor losses. Yeah, so that's also what you can do with this. And then we do the thermal analysis. So we do the thermal analysis because we have all the losses now. We can do the thermal analysis. And then usually we go back and we reiterate. We do a Pareto front or Monte Carlo or whatever you want, kind of optimization. Yeah, and you start to simulate backwards and forwards. Yeah, in order to find a compromise between all this. Engineering is not a direct street where we go in and we know the end. Yeah, we go into a street and we have a maze and we can choose different solutions to get to the end path. Yeah, so this is what we are trying to do here in order to simulate. Yeah, so this is the feedback loop. Yeah, so this feedback loop is not once, not twice, but many, many times. Yeah, because we have to know all these parts in order to come to the right solution. And then somehow we reach the design. Somehow. And I want to make the equivalent with this. Yeah, so so if I start watching, this is the best show ever. The next one is, I think I found a new favorite channel or character. No, why? Oh God, why? I would never watch this stupid again. This is like watching football. Yeah, so if I watch football, I watch my favorite team. Yeah. I get irritated because they are lagging behind and then I'm never watching again. But next time I'm watching again. Yeah. So this is the iterative circle I have to continuously go through as a spectator of my club, which is at the bottom of the Dutch league. Yeah. So I have to take a lot of punches, but still I will support them and keep going. And I will go to the game every time, although I know that the chances of winning might not be so high. Yeah. But still we support them. This is the same as optimization. Optimization is something that you know that is going to be hard. You know that you will get punched. You know that you are failures, but this is what we do. Okay, so we look at all these parts. If we look at the rotor dimensions, we have to think about the magnet flying out. So the magnet at high speed flies out and we have to use a containment to contain it. So that's what is shown on the right. It's just a simple illustration of what the magnet is doing. It acting as a dead weight, dead mass, to the containment. Here you see the influence of magnet thickness on the containment thickness. So the thicker we make the magnet, the better the magnetic field strength, or the higher the magnetic field strength in the air gap. But there's a compromise, because the thicker the magnet, the thicker the containment. So actually there's a compromise between those two. And that's shown here. Yeah, so you have a compromise between containment thickness and magnet thickness. If I make one thicker, the other one also has to increase size. So I have to think about it. Yeah, so we come up with a solution. Yeah, so we look at the laws of the mechanical engineering. A motor designer is also a mechanical engineer, because we have to know all these parts in order to get to a real solution. Then we look, of course, at the von Mises stress. And in this machine, we reach 2300 kilometers an hour. So we're not at the 3000 level yet, as with the flywheel, but we are getting close. Yeah, so this is quite close to reaching that limit. So we look at analytical approach. Yeah, so we make analytical equations with our famous electrical equivalent circuit. Yeah, so mechanical equivalent circuit is what we use here also, in order, and then we use finite element analysis in order to verify whether what we do is also the truth. And we make sure that we are crossing the line at the right point in order not to lose contact between the magnet and the rotor. Because otherwise, if the magnet would go fly out, the rotor would just rotate without touching the magnet anymore. And we will have a failure. So that, with the finite element analysis, this is quite nice to investigate this. Then we also have to look at the containment. Containment is not so simple. Yeah, so containment is quite a challenging component because it's a compromise of resin, of fibers, and they have to be wound in a certain way. Which angle are you using? How are you using the fibers? Yeah, so this is quite challenging. And then we also have cracks. So inside the containment you get cracking, and cracking is something you have to investigate, and this is also what we do then. Especially if we go to higher temperatures, we have to investigate the cracking of the containment quite a lot. So this is what we also do here. We don't do it ourselves, we use partners for this. Then with the electromagnetic design, we also have interpole leakage. That means that if I have a permanent magnet, not all the flux goes radially, also flux goes in circumferential direction and comes back to the other magnets. This is called interpole leakage. So it's a leakage from one pole to the next pole. And what we can do is flux focusing and defocusing. Flux focusing means that if I make the magnet thicker in the middle and less on the outside, I can focus the flux. So I can make like a sinusoidal, or try to make a sinusoidal behavior. And then I also have to consider, of course, the saturation in the stator and the rotor ion. So I have to consider this in detail. Here you see the compromise. So if you look then at the radial component of the flux density in the air gap, you see here the normalized flux density level, and you see here the magnet thickness, and you find an optimum. You start to find an optimum for this compromise. The compromise between containment length, between magnet thickness, between magnet focusing, interpole leakage. So you find an optimum, and that optimum is, of course, where you should be as a motor designer. But we also have to look at the parasitic loss. So we are now at the next level in our, so we started with mechanical design, then we went to magnetostatic, then we went to the Saber analysis, we already did this, and now we are at magnetodynamic. Yeah, so we are looking at the parasitic loss. Parasitic loss means parasites, something you don't want, but they are there. Yeah, so you have to deal with it. Yeah, so you have to get rid of them, or you have to know at least what they are. So that's what you can see here. And we have also magnet loss. It's one of the parasitic effects. So we have time harmonics and we have space harmonics. So both contribute to magnet loss. Space harmonic means if I rotate, I see a variable reluctance, and this variable reluctance gives me space harmonics. Time harmonics means I have a non-ideal sinusoidal current, and it induces time harmonics in my magnet. So these are the two losses that you will have. In a well-designed machine, it only is a very small portion. So parasitic loss maybe is like 0.3% of your efficiency. Yeah, so it's a very, very small part, but they can be very hard to get rid of because your rotor is very difficult to cool. So therefore, in some automotive applications, they use oil cooling, oil spray cooling of the rotor, because they cannot get rid of this rotor loss. Especially in automotive machines where they are increasing the power density, they have a lot of issues like this. They have a lot of challenges there. So they should look at maybe more at the system design and utilize that. So what, how to determine and how to measure and how to cool such a rotor. Although it's a very small percentage, we still have to cool it because it's rotating very fast and it's difficult to get cooling to it. Yeah, so I cannot make fins on it in order to get the heat out. We of course have to minimize the current, the time harmonics. Yeah, so then you have of course limited scope with the uncontrolled rectifier. With an uncontrolled rectifier, it's very difficult to change the current waveform. But we can, because we can make inductance. And inductance is something that helps us, although we have an uncontrolled rectifier from a generator, in order to smooth the current waveform. Another one what we can do is subdivide the magnets. We put the magnets in isolation, like delamination. So this part of the magnet is isolated from that part of the magnet, like in delamination. Yeah, so I make them isolated from each other, so I have less eddy current losses. Another one is a thin copper screen on the surface of my magnets in order to screen the harmonics that come from the stator. So these are different options. Then of course there's many published claims, but very little people measured. Maybe none. Yeah, so it's very difficult to measure. You can make estimations, but it's very difficult to measure this rotor loss. So analyzing challenges, we have to have very limited measurement data. There's no available means of evenly order of magnitude, and it's important to get confidence. So if we simulate something, we want to measure. Because a simulation without measurements means nothing. Yeah? If you change your parameter 10 times, you can have a very good simulation, but in real life, it is not so good as you anticipated. So again, how to determine and measure how to cool. This gives a computational challenge, because in computational magnetodynamic analysis, rotor loss is not so simple. You need quite a good mesh. You need to consider your mesh in quite a good way, because we have to consider skin depth, which is something that screens the magnetic field. Yeah, so we have to consider this. We have to consider eddy currents. We have to consider that there's a 2D behavior or 3D behavior of the eddy currents. So it's quite a difficult analysis. Here you see a first attempt. Yeah, so this just using 2D, and 2D means eddy currents go in that direction and come back in that direction. Yeah, you have no end effects of your eddy currents in this analysis, because this is a 2D analysis. And you see that eddy currents can be quite high. Yeah, we get to 15 amps per millimeter. Normally it's not something you want in your magnets. So you have to do something. Yeah. So here you can also see that I don't start at zero, the simulation, time equals zero, because you need a very large transient. So eddy currents and all these magnetodynamic simulations take a lot of time. It almost becomes like CFD. Yeah, so normally what we say is mechanical analysis, aesthetically relatively simple, finite element. Of course, computational fluid dynamics is very complicated, and we are in between. Yeah, so we are approaching the computational fluid dynamics if you go into all these parasitic effects. Well, we also built the motor. So we also built the motor for this application. We use dual winding in order to compensate for the voltage regulation. And we have a test bench that we can use. We have an uncontrolled rectifier. We have the generator. And we actually look at that TC behavior. Here we see the rotor. And the rotor we were equipping with sensors. And also one particular sensor that was looking through the stator. So we made a hole in the stator tooth in order to have an infrared camera looking at the rotor surface, because we were very scared of the carbon fiber behavior, and the carbon fiber manufacturer told maximum temperatures like that. So we had to limit, so we use an infrared camera in order to IR, in order to look at the surface of the rotor to measure it. So that was one way. We also equipped the rotor with a lot of thermal sensors, and we made a plug here on the outside that we can connect. So we can stop this motor, plug it in, and directly log all the temperatures versus time. So if you know a little bit about thermal behavior, yeah, so if I have temperature and I have time, I have C, which is heat capacity, I have R, which is like the steady state behavior of your thermal circuit, and I have a characteristic like this. So this is how every material heats up. Yeah, so there's a C, capacity, there's an R at the end, overall R, which is conduction, convection, everything together, but it shows this behavior. But also it shows this behavior when I stop it. So when I stop it, I get the C again, and I get the behavior going down. Yeah, so actually you have it on both sides. So we utilize that behavior in order to look at the cooling down curve. And from the cooling down curve, you can actually extrapolate back up to the point that you missed. Because of course you cannot be infinitely fast to this, you are a little bit slow. You have to stop the machine, you have to run into the test room, connect it, it takes some time. Yeah, it takes about four seconds in order to do that. And that's why we made this analysis. Here you see inside the magnet, so the magnet is separated, yeah, so it's isolated from each other. Yeah, so there is actually isolated magnets, and we made some holes in the magnet. And the holes in the magnet is there to put temperature sensors. So the temperature sensors are in the magnets in order to measure different parts of the magnet. Here you see them. Yeah? There's channels for embedding thermocouples or PT100 or whatever thermal device you would like to use. So we also made the thermal model. So here we get to our thermal equivalent circuit. So from the motor, we make our own thermal model, and we look at all the losses, all the parasitic losses, all the conduction, all the convection, all the different parts that are there. So this is looking at also end caps. So how does a rotor, if it rotates in air, How does it create drag? And what is this drag loss? So air drag loss is also included in this analysis. Even bearing losses. Huh? So bearing here, you have the bearing loss. It is incorporated. Here you see also the behavior to the outside. Huh? So you can have a voltage source on the outside to actually offset your simulation in order also to include ambient temperature in this. Of course, we have some assumptions. Huh? So you have assumption that we have homogeneous temperatures, which is an assumption. We have ideal contact materials, although sometimes we make on purpose a small contact between, for instance, stator lamination and stator housing in order to simulate the resistance. We have smooth surfaces, we have heat flows in different direction, mean temperature, and we have losses that are computed as mentioned before. And so all the losses are computed and are inserted in this analysis. We also made it visual, yeah, in order to understand the behavior. We just have uniform temperatures, but we can see the different temperatures. The arrows indicate the flow of the heat flux, yeah? So heat flow. So a big arrow means that quite a lot of heat is going there, and a small arrow is little heat is going there. So the arrow is just an indication, it scales with how much heat is actually dissipated via those areas. And this is then the real degree C, Celsius. Here you see the rise of the temperature of the rotor core, of the magnet, of the measured air, of the frame. This is what we measured and what we simulated. So we are relatively close to what we actually tried to achieve. And here you see this is for natural cooling. So we also had forced convection cooling, both in the machine and on the outside of the machine, in order to check, does it change, does it not change, what changes, how does it change. So all this was done. Yeah, so these are just some results of that. Yeah, so this is the magnet temperature with natural cooling. Yeah, so this is at 5,000 RPM, 7,500 RPM, 10,000 RPM. Here you see also this forced air cooling, so that we can change. So we use a ventilator. Yeah, just a standard high pressure ventilator, put it on the top, and we could insert flow of air inside our caloric chamber. And this caloric chamber we used also to look at the losses in another matter. Here you see the gap that went through for the infrared sensor, that went through the stator in order to look at the rotor surface. Here you see us running in and stopping the machine. Starting the machine, stopping the machine, starting the machine, stopping the machine, going in, putting the plug, taking it out, running it, putting the plug, running it. Yeah, so we are using a duty cycle. And of course, we know that if we use a duty cycle, we don't reach the same steady state temperature. We know this. Yeah? So if you have a certain duty cycle, you are lower. That's why an electric motor can do very high peak torques, very high peak powers for a short amount of time. And this is what we do here. And here you see then we walk in, and we actually take the temperature. Yeah, and then we make an estimation. We use like a generic algorithm in order to make an analysis of our thermal equivalent model. And we stipulate that onto our temperature versus time behavior. And this is what you show here. Yeah, for different speeds, we were of course investigating, and also for different loads. Here you see again the magnet temperature with natural cooling and forced cooling. Makes quite a big difference what we reached, actually. Although we have containment on the outside, and the containment on the outside is a thermal isolator. Here you see our current waveform and voltage waveforms, what we predicted and what we measured. Because we are an uncontrolled rectifier, but we have designed the inductors accordingly, we have quite a sinusoidal current instead of the two-mountain current. Yeah, so normally it's like this. We have quite a sinusoidal current because, of course, we took care of our inductance. And here you see then the voltage of the uncontrolled rectifier. And you see the efficiency map. Yeah, so this is just an efficiency map of the whole behavior. And you see that you can reach quite high efficiencies. Yeah? So we reached 98%. Yeah, but, of course, we start at different levels. This is quite a challenging chart to make, because normally you should do this at constant temperature. So constant temperature is something you should use in your efficiency map. Actually, you should not have a different temperature there, because your couple loss would be different. So what you can do is, of course, compensate for that, because if you know temperature, you can compensate for it. But what we try to do is stay constant. So this analysis, what is shown here, it took us more than 6 months to measure this. Because it's many, many measurements, many, many data, many, many parts, yeah, in order to actually achieve this. That's also why it's so detailed. Yeah? And you see multiple optimization parts. We also have failures. If we are pushing the limit, we also have a failure. So here we had a bearing failure because, of course, most of our heat was, or quite a lot of heat was going through the shaft, and this destroyed the bearing. Yeah, so we had to look at different greases, different balls. Yeah, so we went to double contact bearings. It was solved, of course, but it always takes a little bit of time. And it's something that you do. If you develop motors, you have to deal with failures. It is how you learn from the failures that will make us and you a better engineer. Yeah, because engineers need failures. Yeah, if you just make a success story, I'm really sorry, it doesn't work. It's not there. It's not real. Yeah, we all have failures. We all have mistakes. We all have things that explode. Hopefully we don't, you know, nothing happens from the explosion, yeah, but it happens. So the conclusion is that we did an analytical calculation. We have a prototype built. We have used a natural cooling and forced cooling for our specific customer. Yeah, we don't go in all details. And this is our last statement for today. So it is from Rolls-Royce. Take the best of what exists and makes it better. When it does not design, that does not exist, design it. This is what we do. So what we do is, if you have something you can utilize, please use that. Because we do not have to develop, take that. If you want something special, if you want something different, if you want the client specific, if you want to look at really the application, come to us. And we will try to help you in order to provide you with a solution that is the best for your application. Of course we will have failures. Of course we will, if we push the limits, we sometimes cross the limit. Yeah, it's not without failure. Yeah, but we will do our utmost best to help you to make your electric drive the best suited for your application. So basically, that's where my presentation ends. I hope you enjoyed it. Some people actually managed 2 hours. I hope I was a little bit entertaining. It was not boring. Yeah, so I tried to do my best. There's a lot of information. Yeah, a lot of things we have discussed. Yeah, but hopefully take it to your advantage. Yeah, and you know, when it does not exist, design it. That's what we are engineers for. Yeah, that's why we didn't become physicists. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, and have a nice exhibition. Yeah, for the rest. Are there any questions? If you want questions, you can have them. You can also come later.